Okay, welcome everybody. I can see that a few people are still joining us, so I'll give us another couple of seconds before we get started. Okay, well, welcome everybody to this third session of our series on decolonizing education for sustainable futures. This session is called Education's Reparative Possibilities, Responsibilities and Reckonings for Sustainable Futures. My name's Arathi Sriprakash. I'm a sociologist of education at the University of Bristol, and I'm delighted to chair today's webinar. The series takes UNESCO's Futures of Education initiative as a springboard for reimagining how knowledge and learning can shape the future of humanity and the planet. And if you haven't already had a chance to explore UNESCO's Future of Education website, I encourage you to do so, as there are many ways of getting involved in this initiative. And I think Raphael can put a link to the website in the chat for you. Our conversations in this series have been hosted at the University of Bristol as an initiative of the UNESCO Chair on Inclusive and Quality Education. And it's been a truly collaborative endeavor. And I'd quickly like to thank Leon Tickley, Raphael Mitchell, Artemio Cortez, Christy Smith, Angeline Barrett, Julia Paulson, Yvette Hutchinson, and Keith Holmes for their extraordinary work over many months, as well as our many hundreds of participants from around the world who have logged in each week to join us in these series of conversations. So thank you, and it's absolutely fantastic to see all of you here today. Today's session will be simultaneously interpreted to offer English and Spanish streams. So I hope you've found the right place to be. Have a look at the bottom of your screen to make sure that you're on the right channel. There's an English and Spanish channel. This simultaneous interpretation has been made possible through the kind support of EDJAM, the Education, Justice and Memory Network, which we're going to hear more about today, as well as the energy and skills of Rosemary Luz, Teresa Lopez, Carolina Valladares Celes, Katiuska Ferreira Portillo, and Caroline Bardrick. I'd like to take a little bit of time just to briefly contextualize today's conversation. Previous sessions in the series have considered how decolonizing knowledge and anti-racist education are central to imagining a collective future in sustainable and just terms. Our first session offered insights into the theoretical and political connections between decolonial and environmental justice agendas in education, seeing these as inextricably linked. Last week, we considered the responsibilities and actions of educational institutions from schools and universities and British Council in decolonizing their curriculum and practices. And if you'd like to review those discussions, the videos for both webinars are available online, and we'll put the link in the chat as well. This week, we're going to be building on these discussions to explore the reparative possibilities of education. That is, how ideas of repair, restitution, and reparation can be brought to educational struggles over the future in order to address education's enduring complicity with coloniality and environmental injustice. I'm absolutely delighted to introduce the panel and the format for today's discussion. First, we're going to be hearing from Tarsila Rivera-Zay, who is an activist for the Quechua people of Peru, and dedicated to defending the rights of Indigenous people. Tarsila chairs the Center for Indigenous Cultures of Peru and is the president of the International Forum of Indigenous Women. Drawing on her long-standing work, Tarsila will be speaking about how peace and sustainable living requires challenging the hierarchical and monocultural forms of education that have been imposed on Indigenous people and which have legitimized racist and exclusive societies. We'll then turn to Dr. Keston Perry, who is a political economist and interdisciplinary scholar at the University of West of England. Kesson's recent work focuses on the case for climate reparations, something he'll be talking about with us today. His work acknowledges the colonialities that underpin development finance specifically related to climate change and recognizing the ongoing processes of climate imperialism. Finally, we're going to be hearing from Dr. Julia Paulson, who is a transitional justice and peace education scholar at the University of Bristol and lead of the Education, Justice and Memory Network. Julia will be discussing the idea of education as a site of active memory production and how this opens up possibilities for reparative pedagogical work from teachers, activists, and learners. She'll be sharing some of the examples from her EDJAM colleagues in Cambodia and Colombia to reflect on how such pedagogies might help push for material and symbolic reparations, something I'll talk a bit about in a moment. We really encourage you to participate actively through the talk, so please feel free to use the Q&A function to ask questions to the panelists, and you're free to write in either Spanish or in English. We'll address these questions at the end of the presentations. And if you've got thoughts or resources to share with other participants, please do feel free to use the chat or simply to say hello. So before I hand over to the panel, I'd like to say a few words about education and reparative justice to offer a few points of entry, if you like, into our conversations today. So as many of you may know, the UNESCO Futures of Education initiative is called Learning to Become. Contained in this phrase, learning to become, is an acknowledgement that the future is not static or fixed, but through learning, it can be made. However, in looking towards the future, what parts of the past and present do we want to bring with us? And what parts need to be acknowledged and challenged today so that they do not structure tomorrow? This connection between the past, present, and future was the focus of a recent piece of work that I conducted for UNESCO with colleagues Kevin Myers, David Natley, and Pedro Ramos Pinto. We argued that any discussion about the futures of education needs to acknowledge the systems of domination which haunt life all around us, in buildings and statues, in financial systems and knowledge systems, in the very ways we understand learning and education itself. Injustices that may appear to be distant in time or over will continue to endure in people's lives in material and effective ways. The scars of racism and coloniality, which was the specific focus of our analysis, continue to be deeply felt and continue to deeply divide. We argue that we cannot be seduced by a future that doesn't seek to repair injustices of the past and present. In short, we call for a concept of the future that is reparative in order to challenge rather than reproduce systems of domination. What does a reparative future look like, and what is education's role in it? Well, this is a big set of questions that I think I would love to talk to you all about more and hear your thoughts on. A few brief thoughts on this. We can think about reparative justice as having material forms, repayment of what is owed. Think, for example, the educational and generational debt owed to those who have been systematically excluded from or harmed by education. And this is where I think a much more focused analysis of the relationship between education and racial capitalism is needed within the field of education. Reparative justice can also have symbolic forms. Think, for example, of the renaming and recontextualizing of sites and institutions which carry the labels and histories of white supremacy, histories that otherwise go unchecked and uninterrogated. Reparative justice can also have pedagogic forms. This is about how we can learn anew to nurture futures that are not structured around the dispossession of people and the planet. How we can learn to build new relations of reciprocity, collaborative interpretation, and collective organization to imagine life beyond all forms of injustice. And here I think we can understand those efforts to decolonize knowledge and decolonize education that we spoke about in previous sessions as having a reparative potential. We suggest that these forms of reparative justice, the material, symbolic, and pedagogic, interact with each other, and education has a key role to play in this. It is precisely through education that new forms of recognition of injustice and a solidarity for creating something different can be fostered. We argue education is therefore necessary for reparative futures. And so it's with these reflections that I'd like to now turn to our panel to continue these conversations. And Tarsila, if you're there, can we hear from you first, please?
Bueno, muy buenas tardes, buenas noches. Yapaikichik tari maikulia ikichik ukoison joimanta in kapa runa simimpi. Con todo cariño les mando un saludo desde el fondo de mi corazón en mi lengua madre, que es la lengua de los incas. A nivel global tenemos que hacer referencia a los incas. De esa civilización venimos en esta región del mundo. Agradezco y felicito la oportunidad de poder compartir palabras, pensamientos, esperanzas, ¿no? Y felicito también a la universidad y esta articulación con la UNESCO para llegar a un espacio, digamos, más amplio y global como permite la tecnología, lo cual felicito, ¿no? Gracias, doctora, por la invitación, Julia. Y empiezo diciendo que en el mundo los pueblos indígenas somos más o menos 480 millones y nos dividimos en regiones geoculturales desde las Naciones Unidas. En las Américas estamos llegando casi a 50 millones. En todas partes, los pueblos indígenas hemos pasado todas las formas, ¿no?, para tratar de lograr que no sigamos siendo nosotros mismos. Entonces, hemos pasado invasiones, colonizaciones, evangelización, ideologización y politización. Y en los últimos tiempos, cuando empiezan a desaparecer las colonias y empezamos a formar los estados, nación o las repúblicas, donde también los indígenas y las indígenas participamos con la esperanza de libertad, de adquirir derechos legítimos en un estado nuevo. Teóricamente, estados democráticos. Sin embargo, el establecimiento de las repúblicas en nuestros países no ha significado el reconocimiento y la legitimación de derechos de esos pueblos y culturas preexistentes a las colonias. Entonces, relacionando este proceso con la educación, desde esa estructura de los estados, como ustedes lo saben, se implanta un sistema de educación totalmente, nosotros le llamamos etnocéntrica o eurocéntrica, ¿no? Desde una hegemonía de Occidente, sin tener en cuenta las expresiones de las diversas culturas y pueblos que somos también parte de ese medio social, de ese medio geográfico. Entonces, todas estas formas de querer convertirnos en mejores personas o civilizadas nos han ido dañando más bien la oportunidad de ser seres humanos con dignidad y con libertad de aportar, de hacer conocer lo que sabemos, cómo pensamos y compartir nuestras formas de convivir con la naturaleza y entre nosotros mismos. Entonces, para nosotros esa es una primera barrera que hace que la educación vista más bien como un privilegio contribuyó más bien a crear jerarquías y estatus. Y entonces pasamos muchos pueblos a mirar cómo la sociedad se desenvuelve, cómo se ejerce el poder y cómo las estructuras de ese poder nos han ido dejando de lado y llegamos a comprender en estos últimos tiempos, quizá los últimos 20 años en general, que tenemos estados con sistemas de ejercer el poder en una forma totalmente racista que se expresa en las discriminaciones y las exclusiones. Llámese ejercicio del poder solo desde un sector, llámese ejercicio del poder en una forma totalmente patriarcal, pero también en una forma totalmente racista y discriminadora. Entonces, la educación pública, que es al que debemos acceder los pueblos, nos encontramos con una serie de barreras cuando entramos al aula. Es el lugar donde lamentablemente se legitima una forma de negar la existencia, los aportes y los valores del otro, que no es el legítimo. Entonces, las mujeres indígenas, por ejemplo, hemos definido que la peor forma de violencia a la que nos enfrentamos las mujeres indígenas en nuestras sociedades es el racismo y la discriminación. ¿Por qué? Porque al entrar al aula donde no se habla tu idioma, no se valida tu vestimenta, no se toma en cuenta tus expresiones culturales de conocimiento, de recursos, de lo que, con lo que venimos como carga cultural, entonces empezamos a perder nuestra autoestima, porque ya empezamos a creer que verdaderamente no tenemos los mismos derechos que otros, porque el espacio que es visto como el espacio del saber, del desarrollo de la persona, de adquirir nuevos conocimientos, nos va deslegitimando. Esa es la experiencia que yo he tenido. He sido monolingüe hasta los 10 años y entonces adquirí otras herramientas para ser más fuerte y decir no, no podemos ceder a lo que dicen que debemos hacer cuando en realidad nuestra dignidad es lo único y más importante que nos mueve para seguir mirando el mundo de otra manera. En este sentido, cuando empezamos nuestras propuestas desde esta asociación indígena, hicimos un primer ejercicio. En ese contexto, ¿qué es lo que tenemos para transmitir a nuestro pueblo, para compartir con la sociedad? Entonces, ideamos un concepto que se llamaba hacia nosotros mismos, hacia nosotras mismas. ¿Qué quiere decir? ¿Cómo podríamos sanar esos dolores que traíamos como efecto de las formas de exclusión, discriminación o negación de nosotros mismos? Que teníamos autoestima baja, sin conciencia de derecho porque nos la negaban. Por favor, hay cruce en la interpretación. ¿Está bien? Ya, ahora sí. Entonces, cuando empezamos a mirarnos a nosotros mismos, dijimos, ¿cómo curarnos de ese dolor, de esa negación de nuestra propia dignidad, para luego transmitir lo que realmente somos, lo que realmente tenemos y lo que realmente quisiéramos como sociedad? Entonces, haciendo el camino hacia nosotros mismos, dijimos, no más resentimiento, no imagen de víctima, sino sacar todo lo que heredamos de nuestros ancestros. Y esto, hasta el momento, aún no se refleja en los contenidos educativos formales. Entonces, iniciamos propuestas, por ejemplo, en contextos de violencia política con niños refugiados, de cómo podíamos responder en espacios de formación esa necesidad de reconocernos y autoafirmarnos. Les cuento, queridas personas del mundo, que tenemos ejemplos de hombres y mujeres que cuyo único camino era aceptar que es un oprimido o escoger el camino no correcto en sociedades marginales. Ahora tenemos esas jóvenes, hombres y mujeres, con liderazgos positivos, abiertos de mentalidad al mundo, pero que siguen siendo quechuas, que siguen siendo aymaras y van con esa dignidad y esa autoestima afirmada, abriéndose al mundo. Entonces, cuando pensamos en una educación sanadora y reparadora, creo que tenemos que pensar que el aspecto más importante de reparación y sanación tiene que ser una educación que realmente garantice una relación de respeto entre nosotros, entre las diferencias. Que haya un ejercicio de oportunidades de ejercer poder justamente basado en el respeto y en el derecho de los demás. Que el poder, pequeño o grande, sea usado de buena manera para políticas que dignifiquen a las personas, a los seres humanos, y contribuyan de forma positiva en la formación de ese ser humano que va desde el aula o desde los espacios de formación. Decimos esto porque cuando nos ponemos en el escenario global donde la carrera armamentista, la carrera de pelea por el poder, de quién tiene más poder económico y quién puede más, nos está deshumanizando. Y consideramos que por eso la educación formal y no formal tiene bastante responsabilidad justamente en el cambio de mentalidades, que no sea solo para acceder a nueva tecnología como economía, acceder a nueva tecnología para desarrollar el conocimiento, desarrollar valores, democratizar oportunidades. Eso es lo que soñamos como una educación que pueda hacer sostenible la paz. Muchas veces a los pueblos que tenemos capacidad crítica o grupos nos relacionan con gentes conflictivas, terroristas, que estamos siempre en contra de todo, pero no se ponen a pensar que estamos reclamando derechos negados y negados formalmente porque la estructura de nuestros estados todavía no nos incluye ni en la vida política, económica, social ni cultural. Entonces, alguien que no tiene las mismas oportunidades que otros, por supuesto, tenemos el derecho de usar nuestra palabra, de usar nuestra voz, porque felizmente no hemos perdido la capacidad crítica sobre situaciones que son injustas. Entonces, volviendo, por ejemplo, a la función de sanador, reparador, pienso que el aspecto de reparación, sanación desde la perspectiva educativa tiene que estar más relacionado a nuestro ser, a nuestra humanidad y a nuestro, ¿cómo se llama esto?, que no es material. Por supuesto que el Estado, cuando quiera y acepte que debemos tener educación de calidad, también tiene que invertir como reparación de los presupuestos públicos en espacios de educación apropiados y tiene que invertir en la formación de docentes que realmente tengan las mismas oportunidades y las mismas herramientas como para transmitir una nueva forma de educación y de transmitir conocimientos y contenido. En ese sentido, creemos que todos los seres humanos tenemos el derecho de acceder a oportunidades. No estamos diciendo que toditos vamos a ser iguales. No podemos ser todos iguales, ¿no? Pero sí tener la oportunidad de encontrar espacios de diálogo donde los conocimientos de unos, los saberes de otros, puedan dialogar armónicamente y puedan servir para construir justamente la paz y la relación armónica entre nosotros. No nos oponemos al avance científico, tecnológico, por supuesto, todos lo merecemos. Entonces, nosotras, las mujeres indígenas que hacemos y estamos comprometidas con la educación y la nueva generación, sí queremos que nuestros hijos de diferentes pueblos indígenas sean ciudadanas y ciudadanos universales, que sus expresiones y la carga cultural que tienen de sus culturas de origen sea un motivo de orgullo, de dignidad y que puedan también entrar en el escenario donde se dialoguen las diversidades respetando las diferencias. Creo que lo que más nos debe dar sostenibilidad es esto, la formación de nuevas generaciones que crezcan teniendo esta mirada de el diferente, algo sabe, algo tiene que compartir y no verlo como alguien que es el atraso de la sociedad o son ciudadanos de tercera o que son ignorantes. Hasta ahora es algo que discutimos y esperemos que cambie. No sé si ya cumplí los minutos, por favor, ¿qué señita me puede hacer? ¿Un minuto? Bueno, en ese escenario, imagínense las mujeres indígenas, que en nuestros estados y nuestras sociedades mal aprenden, por ejemplo, acerca del patriarcado, acerca del machismo. Todo esta imagen de ejercicio de poder tan vertical también nos salpica y nos daña triplemente. Entonces, las mujeres indígenas, segundas para la educación, sin oportunidades para seguir creciendo y ser ellas mismas, sometidas a una relación de poder de segunda clase. Entonces, ni dentro de la sociedad indígena actual, ni fuera, tiene las mismas oportunidades que los varoncitos. ¿Por qué? Porque como hemos pasado por todas estas formas de colonizar y de todo, creemos que solo somos para marido o somos para trabajo doméstico. Y entonces las oportunidades negadas y con la autoestima baja y con no oportunidades igual que otros, estamos, por ser indígenas, por ser mujeres y por ser pobres, en peor situación. Pero estamos recuperando justamente las imágenes de mujeres indígenas que lucharon, que levantaron la cabeza, que adquirieron fortaleza y transmitiendo eso a las nuevas generaciones. Entonces, basta de opresión y la educación tiene que ser dignificadora y fortalecer nuestro espíritu, nuestra emocionalidad y nuestra visión de convivencia con la madre naturaleza que nos dio vida, nos da vida, nos da todo para comer, alimentarnos y dejar un poco de lado esta carrera del consumismo, de la depredación, de la ambición de poder desmedido y de dañar el espacio común que es el mundo, la naturaleza y los el medio ambiente, el ambiente sano. Es eso, ¿no? En general, y yo espero las preguntas para la segunda ronda y escuchar a las demás personas. Y muchas gracias por la atención.
Asila, thank you so much for those inspiring and important words. I think as one of our participants have picked up your words on the need for education to be dignifying is a message that will stay with us all. Thank you. Kirsten, if you're ready, it would be wonderful to hear from you.
Sure, thank you. And I must share as well my thank you to Tasila for starting us off on a really good note, I think, in understanding the experiences of indigenous peoples in Peru and in Latin America and the Americas. I think it's absolutely fundamental to our discussion today on reparations and to what I'm going to share about in terms of climate reparations and what this means for reparatory justice in general. As a political economist, I'm going to share a bit of data to start off with to get us going in terms of, so this is what I'm going to do, try to do it in the next 10 minutes or so, 10, 15 minutes. I'm going to share a brief outline of some data with respect to climate-related losses and the impact that colonialism has had on climate injustices that are that disproportionately affect countries in the global south and communities in the global south in particular, especially racialized Black and Indigenous communities as well. And I'm going to share with you the idea based on, obviously, on social movements, activities that have brought forward the idea of climate debt and climate reparations in this particular case, and I'm going to try to end there. So in terms of giving a picture of where we're at in 2019, this was a picture showing major climatological, geophysical, and meteorological events that happened in 2019. And we can see based, I wanted us to focus a bit on the global south countries. And we can see on the far right left of the image at the bottom left, we can see Hurricane Dorian, which impacted several Caribbean countries in that in the region. And it in the case of the Bahamas in particular, it accumulated losses that amounted to over $3.4 billion in one episode, in one hurricane. And you know, a number of other islands were impacted as well, included the Barbados, British Virgin Islands, Dominica, and so on. And we can see, in addition, overall losses due to Hurricane Dorian, this is one hurricane that happened in that period. In 2020, we also had over 30 storms that were formed in the Atlantic Sea and in the Atlantic hurricane season, and it caused over 400 deaths. If we look at the Caribbean region, it is a region that is most affected, and I will show you on the next slide how that those impacts are being felt in economic terms. In the Southern African, Southeastern Africa, we can see Cyclone Idai. There was also another major cyclone, Cyclone Kenneth, which affected several Southern African countries, including Malawi. Mozambique would have been the country most affected. And in Mozambique, it caused damage amounting to over $3 billion. And it has increased the public debt levels in several of these countries which are impacted by these storms. In Southern India as well, we had major flooding and landslides causing over $7 billion in debt. So compared to the global north countries, countries in the global south, especially those in the Caribbean with which I'm most familiar, when they're impacted by these major climate-related events, it is the entire country that is impacted, the entire economy. In the case of Antigua and Barbuda in 2017, an entire island in Barbuda was 90% damaged due to Hurricane Irma. So the impacts that we can see as a result of climate-related events are disproportionately visited upon countries in the global south. In the Caribbean region, I wanted to point out from the United Nations report that was completed last year on the human cost of disasters showed that of the 10 countries that are most affected in terms of economic losses as a percentage of GDP, 9 of those countries reside in the Caribbean region. So, you know, it is no secret now, or it should be no secret, that where global capitalism was birthed through the plantation economies in the Caribbean region, drawing upon work from Eric Williams and so on, we can see these are the countries and these are the societies that are being most impacted by climate-related losses. And we can see in terms of economic impacts, Guyana being on the South American continent, it's cost over 3.6% of its GDP. Haiti, which is also a country I study closely, 8% of GDP over this 20-year period. And Dominica, which was most impacted over this period, over 15% of GDP. This region only houses, if we consider all of the littoral region, only has 44 million people. So this is one small state in the United States. 44 million people. If we think of the English-speaking region alone, it's about 9 million people. So it is very important that we think about the widespread devastation that is caused by climate change in these particular regions. And I want to link this obviously to the experience and the process of colonialism. Based on these plantation societies being established in the Caribbean and throughout you know, a number of regions in northern Brazil and so on, the levels of exploitation, resource extraction that were linked to subjugated racialized labor was very important for industrial capitalism that has contributed to accumulating greenhouse gas emissions that we know today as impacting on the climate and as resulting in global warming, right? And there's a major, we need to see it as a continuity, colonialism as starting the process of increasing greenhouse gas emissions and continuing to today as in the forms of major losses, in the forms of the kinds of economic and environmental practices that we saw started in the region, in the Caribbean region in particular, and of course, many countries in the global south. You know, many of these countries were set up as plantations. Therefore, the kinds of crops and agriculture that was cultivated in these regions resulted in devastation of the land, devastation of the topography of the land, and completely almost decimated the resilience and the ability for the land to revive itself as compared to how indigenous practices were meant to ensure that the land was revived, ensure that the land maintained itself, and our collective approach and our collective way of understanding the land was completely part of who we were. Colonialism completely destroyed that particular understanding of ourselves and also of the land, and in terms of the environment and environmental degradation that resulted. I wanted to show this particular graph as it shows a number of Global South countries here, which have experienced very long periods of colonialism, starting way back to the 17th century in some cases, and the 16th century in some Central American countries as well, where the process of setting up plantations, the process of extracting resources from these regions resulted in to today contemporary manifestations of climate change and the inability on the one hand for these countries to meet this sort of relief and recovery needs of their societies and their populations, but have also resulted, we can see on the far end of the table of these countries, the larger numbers are those countries that are most vulnerable to climate change according to this Notre Dame Adaptation Index. So there is a process of colonialism that we can see that shows us a long line from the historical episode to the present day in terms of the loss and damage that countries like Haiti, we can see over 418 million US dollars on average is lost over this period from 1997 to 2016. The Philippines over $2.8 billion, Vietnam $2 billion. Vietnam was as you know, colonized by European powers as well. So we can see here, I wanted to show how these things map out in terms of these kinds of impacts. And who is responsible for climate change, you might say? When we're connecting it, I connect this process to the historical process of colonialism. And the records and the data that we now have available showing the global historical carbon emissions, we can see the yellow part of this graph shows us the European 28 countries. This includes Great Britain. And the green line on here shows us the United States. And these two regions of the world have been responsible historically for 47% of global carbon emissions historically from the time of the Industrial Revolution to the present. And we can see there's a direct link, obviously, because these two regions have been and are in some cases, in the case of Puerto Rico, are former colonizing territories, are former colonizing and imperial regions. And we can see the impacts today that are felt by regions that are least responsible for the climate change. In terms of where do we go from here? I think it's important, one, to set the record straight with respect to how we see those continuities of history and see how we can repair the impacts that are being felt today in many of these countries, and how we can begin the process of re-educating communities and re-educating our societies, in part, especially in the case of the United Kingdom, where I am currently, where there's an amnesia around the history of empire. There's an amnesia around the history of colonialism. And there's sometimes an even a disregard for the fact that these societies were controlled, were ruled for over 500 years in some cases, right? And for in order to begin this process of repair, I think we need to frame this as climate reparations, as a program that compensates countries for the losses and damage that they have felt. In the case of Dominica, we can see after Hurricane Irma hit that country, over 77% of its losses and damage have gone unfunded, have not been met by international funding sources. Internationally, due to the climate accord in 2015, loss and damage does not currently constitute one area of direct financing to countries in the global south. And there are also non-economic losses as a result of these kinds of devastating experiences in terms of healthcare, in terms of inability of governments and communities to educate their population because they're trying to get life started. In many cases, the kinds of trauma, the kinds of economic and geographic displacement that they have felt as a result of many of these kinds of devastating experiences point us to the fact that we need a new way of conceptualizing what repair is, and we need a new way of conceptualizing and understanding what the costs have been for, with respect to climate change. It is highly uneven. And societies in the global south, especially in the Caribbean and other regions that have experienced the legacies of colonialism, are unable to some degree to meet the recovery needs, to build back and to really have societies and cohesive societies to be able to have some level of prosperity, equity, and ensure that systems of oppression are dismantled to the extent that these societies can exist in some form of harmony and in some form of what we might consider justice. So I'm going to end there. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Keston. I think your thoughts on climate reparations foregrounds that that continuity of colonial history. And as you said, that's been a systemic, perhaps even willful amnesia, one in which I think many of our participants are from the field of education can think with and think about what the educational implications are. And that gives us a nice link, I think, to Julia's presentation, which considers these structural amnesias, systemic amnesias through a lens on memory and memory work in education. So over to you, Julia.
Thank you. Let me just share my screen. Perfect. Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much for those presentations, Tarsila and Keston, that have really, I think, brought home the need for these conversations and the need for new imaginings of repair and reparation in and through and beyond education. Buen día a todos y todas. Gracias por estar aquí con nosotros. It's wonderful to hold this event in English and Spanish. So thank you to our interpreters and colleagues who've made that possible. And it's a real honor to be able to share some ideas with you all today. So in this short presentation, I want to explore reparative possibilities in and through education with an attention to teaching and learning about histories of violence and injustice, including colonial histories like Keston and Tarsila have highlighted so powerfully, need teaching and learning about and are often silenced. And I'm fortunate to have been working on these questions for the past several years alongside colleagues in Cambodia, Colombia, Pakistan, Uganda, and here in the UK, including as part of the Education Justice and Memory Network, which I'll tell you a bit more about today. And I just want to highlight that EJAM, the Education Justice and Memory Network, will be commissioning research in these areas. So I would love to invite you all to follow our work, and my colleagues will put links into the chat of how to do so. But we look forward to expanding the network and supporting research to explore these questions. And I think it's really striking. I wanted to start by reflecting on how even very tentative approaches that we might call reparatory to teach history or histories more accurately, to move away from educational contents, practices, policies, and structures that have actively harmed so many young people around the world are met with such powerful backlashes. We're witnessing this at the moment in the UK and the ongoing discussions around academic freedom, and they manifest in multiple ways in different parts of the world. And I think this is a further piece of evidence for the need for repair, reparation, and dialogue in and through education, and the need for reckonings about education's complicities, as the framing of this seminar conversation suggests. And work towards these reckonings is ongoing in different ways and in different spaces, as we've already seen highlighted in our presentations today. Scholars and activists working from Indigenous, Black, decolonial, abolitionist, and ecological perspectives and economic perspectives, which is really heartening to hear from Keston, have all called for a profound reimagining of education and its complicity in systems of domination and oppression, a demilitarization of schools, a revitalization of education at all levels, in the words of Angela Davis. Some research and practice around transitional justice and education in emergencies also advances the need for reckoning and responsibility in and through education, including growing calls that education itself is a site where transitional justice, a process of clarifying, acknowledging, and seeking repair for past injustices, is needed. In some cases, material and symbolic reparations have been part of transitional justice processes, and truth commissions are also increasingly investigating the truth about education within their work to clarify violent pasts and human rights abuses. So exploring education's complicity in those abuses. And they also make recommendations for educational reform. And this is something that more recent truth commissions do with greater frequency. You can see here on this slide a summary of the ways that truth commissions have engaged with education in different ways, with both backward-looking, past-oriented looks at education's complicities and also future-oriented directions for educational reform. And this draws on an analysis that Michelle Bellino and myself did a few years ago. However, it's important for us to note that these transitional justice efforts have largely been partial, both in the degree of change that they're able to propel through their recommendations and also in where their gazes are directed, given that transitional justice and education in emergencies research and practice usually focuses on conflict-affected parts of the global South, while largely ignoring transnational conflict dynamics, coloniality, and racial injustice. It's worth noting also, especially I think for the framing of our seminar and our many guests who work in comparative and international education and education and international development, that these discussions around reckoning, responsibility, and education's complicities in violence and injustice of many forms are almost entirely absent from mainstream international and global education initiatives. For example, the so-called global learning crisis, and also in efforts to achieve sustainable development goal 4 targets around education. Here we tend to see diagnoses of problems without historical analysis that promote technicist solutions and pay little attention to the direct structural and epistemic violences that have underpinned educational expansion. So far I hope I've done a bit more to build on what our previous contributors have highlighted so powerfully already. The need for repair and reparation in and through education is a significant one. And existing attempts through transitional justice processes to achieve this in material and symbolic ways have been partial at best. I now want to move away from these more formalized processes of transitional justice to share and amplify work that educators, activists, artists, and students are doing that we might describe as reparative pedagogy, as Arathi mentioned. And I think Tarsila also shared with us examples of those kinds of practices and pedagogies in the work that she was doing with her colleagues in Peru. So it's possible, I think, that perhaps the energy, the impetus, and the paths for the kind of reimaginings and reinvigorations discussed earlier will come from these practices and will demand those material and symbolic processes follow. For the sake of time, I'll only give two examples that colleagues in EdJam are leading, but if you sign up to our mailing list and check out our website that's coming soon, there's many more examples there. So I first want to highlight the work of the Bopana Audiovisual Resource Center in Cambodia, who are working to develop an app to learn about Khmer Rouge history. This is led by historian Kiu Duong and by Bopana's director, Sophie Chia, who's pictured here with his phone and the app that they've been working on for several years. It's been developed as a collaboration between artists and audiovisual technicians, educators, and fellow historians. And it includes audiovisual content based on survivors' testimonies and on the findings of the extraordinary chambers in the courts of Cambodia. And what the team are currently working on in the EdJam project is to augment the content of the app and to include testimonies from former Khmer Rouge, low-level former Khmer Rouge members, people who were often compelled forcefully to join the Khmer Rouge or who joined due to wartime pressures. And their experiences are largely absent and unheard in educational and transitional justice discourses in Cambodia that tend to maintain a strong binary between victims and perpetrators. So by including these testimonies and developing digital and coronavirus permitting classroom opportunities for intergenerational dialogue with these people who are now in their 70s and 80s, so they really are capturing these testimonies at a very apt moment. Bopana are working to supportively intervene. This is an intervention in the Cambodian education sector, but it's one that's done very supportively and in growing collaboration with the Cambodian Ministry of Education and teacher training colleges. So they're working directly with history teachers as well. So they're intervening in order to open opportunities for intergenerational dialogue and to support moves away from this single consensus narrative while still allowing for the recognition the discussions around responsibility for genocide, but also making space for that recognition of the humanity of ordinary Cambodians who negotiated the Khmer Rouge regime in multiple ways and moving away from that binary account that I mentioned. I now want to share with you the work of Fundación Compartir in Colombia, who are working with seven schools and the education secretariat in Cúcuta, which is the city pictured here on the slide. And the picture with the Poe quote is from one of the schools in Cúcuta. It's a city near the Venezuelan border, which has experienced renewed violence since the peace agreement in 2016 between the FARC and the Colombian government, including violence directed towards educational leaders. And it's also a city that's receiving and welcoming large numbers of Venezuelan migrants into its public schools, which already have large class sizes and limited resources. So given, and of course, are now operating almost entirely online due to coronavirus with all the challenges that that poses. So given these circumstances and constraints that are very immediate, it might seem that the ongoing transitional justice process in Colombia that includes a truth commission would be quite distant from the needs and realities of school leaders, teachers, and students. But that's not how these seven schools are approaching their work. Instead, they've decided to adopt the Colombian Truth Commission's vision of truth as a public good, as an underpinning ethos for the school educational projects that they develop on an annual basis. So this means that truth will underpin their curricula across the board, not just in history teaching, but in all subjects, and will also provide an ethos for the day-to-day functioning of the school. So this, of course, means teaching about Colombia's long armed conflict and about the findings that are emerging from the Truth Commission. But it also means thinking about ways to confront daily mistruth, elisions, and silences that shape interactions at school. This can be seen possibly as an act of pedagogy against what Charles W. Mills describes as structural forms of ignorance and unknowing, which through the management of memory enable blindness to long histories of structural discrimination and injustice. So here schools are trying to be more conscious of their roles in managing memory and to open a more transparent dialogue around truth and how to arrive at it. In both these examples, I think we can see potential for educational processes to actively shape and involve learners in making sense of the past and its meanings in the present, something that Arathi mentioned earlier as well. We've written about this in EdJam as an idea of understanding education as a site of memory production. So in other words, seeing educational spaces as not just stable and authoritative sites where historical narratives decided elsewhere are transmitted unquestioningly to learners, but as spaces of contestation, negotiation, and cultural production where teachers and learners have agency and bring their lived experiences and their understandings of history from their families and their wider communities. Spaces where teachers and learners can intervene in the management of memory and its meanings in the present and for the future. I'm really eager to see people. It's always so strange presenting online and have questions and discussions with everyone. I know we've got some wonderful people present in the audience. So I want to conclude just with a warm invitation to you all to join us next week. We've got a series of events planned to launch the Education, Justice and Memory Network. And again, colleagues will be sharing in the chat how to sign up for these. They include conversations around each of education, justice and memory with colleagues from around the world who've been working in these areas. And also on Friday sessions around the research funding opportunities through EdJam that we very much invite you all to attend. So thanks everyone for your attention.
Thank you so much, Julia. I know that everyone's giving each of our panelists a fantastic round of applause right now. I do appreciate it's hard given that we're all in our separate Zoom boxes at the moment. Thank you everyone for your comments in the chat and your questions posed to panelists. I'd like to take the opportunity now to kind of collect up a few of your questions and pose them to our panel members. If you are still interested in asking a question, please do use the Q&A function and I hope we can get to it. We have about 20 minutes or so for some questions. There's a question from Katerina that's been posed in the Q&A box that's received a number of thumbs up, so a few people are interested in this topic, and I think it follows quite nicely, Julia, from your presentation and speaks to some of the key themes of Tassila's presentation. And it's about the relationship between the concepts of decoloniality and reconciliation. And the specific question is how do panelists view how educational practices can relate to reconciliation processes between Indigenous people and colonial states? There's an acknowledgement that reconciliation is a complex concept in itself. So I wonder if any of the panelists feel like picking up that question about what the sort of relationship between Indigenous people in the colonial state vis-a-vis concepts of reconciliation might be. Tassila?
Empezaré. Después me sigue Kingston, ¿no? Para que haya reconciliación, justamente tiene que haber un proceso educativo y formativo que reconozca el daño que hizo. Y esa es una responsabilidad del Estado junto con la sociedad. No solo el Estado, porque el Estado dictamina, pero si no hay un soporte de formación y de educación que lleve a reconocer los errores que cometimos para luego transitar lo que sería a un diálogo entre iguales. Eso es muy, es un proceso. Y ustedes ven que Canadá, los pueblos indígenas de Canadá, empezaron el proceso de reconciliación desde ellos, después de haber trabajado muchos años logrando instrumentos de derecho desde el espacio internacional. Entonces, ha tomado muchos años y felizmente que el gobierno de los últimos años tiene la apertura, o sea, eso es importante porque tiene que haber una decisión política de los que ejercen el poder para justamente reconocer que han habido actos no correctos con otras culturas, con otros sectores, y se asume esa responsabilidad y se empieza ese proceso que nos llevaría en no sé cuánto tiempo a una reconciliación como sociedad y seres humanos. Ese es un proceso. La otra parte de reparación, es cierto, la reparación para mí es reconocer, pero hacer un acto concreto, que puede ser, hay reparaciones económicas, ¿no? Que en el caso nuestro en Perú, ustedes saben, Julia, usted mencionó el contexto de Camboya y lo iba relacionando con el problema de la violencia política en los Andes peruanos, y nosotros desde la Comisión de la Verdad, sí, lo que tenemos como información es que el 70% de afectados fueron indígenas. Pero imagínense ustedes que por el abuso y desaparición de personas afectadas, muertas en manos del ejército, 10,000 soles, ¿cuánto es 10,000 soles? $3,000. Una reparación económica a las familias. $3,000 para 5 hijos huérfanos destrozados con ese trauma del efecto de la violencia política es nada. El tema de la educación de los hijos que quedaron huérfanos. O sea, han pasado del 80 para acá tantos años. No hay atisbo de reconciliación. No hay reparación justa, porque la estructura y lamentablemente el racismo institucionalizado y desde las estructuras no permiten caminar a acciones para la reconciliación o para la reparación real. Y es cierto, el arte, el reconocimiento de uno mismo es tan sanador que hay muchas iniciativas, pero que lamentablemente son iniciativas que ojalá los estados lo tomaran en cuenta y pueda tener mayor impacto, porque hay muchas iniciativas de educación transformador, ¿no? Pero si nos ubicamos en Colombia, Guatemala, Perú, estamos en proceso después de 30 años. Y Guatemala, por donde uno mire, a pesar de tan fuerte movimiento indígena, seguimos hablando de reparación, de búsqueda de justicia. ¿Por qué? Porque la estructura del poder es lo que la barrera más grande para nosotros, para acceder a reconciliación o reparación. O sea, ahí quedo con mi comentario, pero es algo de la reconciliación debería ser el resultado de un proceso de construcción mutua. Por eso consideramos también que no solo es el afectado, es todos, porque somos sociedades que interactúan con normas lamentablemente jerarquizadas, y es eso que tenemos que cambiar.
Thank you, Tassila. Julia or Kirsten, would you like to come in there, or should I collect up a few other questions?
I think Tassila really handled that well. So I think I mean, in terms of to add what was said, I think there are two barriers at the moment to addressing the problem of reparatory justice. Around climate, but more broadly around, you know, recognizing the crimes of enslavement and in native genocide that happened in the Caribbean and throughout the Americas, is ignorance. I think that's the first barrier. In the UK, we have a serious problem. You can go from primary school or before nursery up to your university education, and you have no collective sense of, or very little sense of, what empire was about and what the kinds of crimes that were related to empire throughout, you know, and what that meant for the continuities of life and existence to today. And how that manifests in various forms through the kinds of actions that are required to address climate change are increasingly parochial, increasingly nation state driven, as opposed to global and addressing the injustices and the uneven impacts that we face. And second, it is definitely the power structure. So I think Tassila really handled that well. The power structure is very, very at the center of the ignorance that we see. And at the center of putting in place both institutions and systems that try to continue and try to perpetuate violences and injustices in various ways. Much of this is ideological, but it's also very much feeding into an economic system of continued environmental degradation, continued exploitation and extraction activities happening in the global south. So yeah, it's definitely, you know, both of those barriers, I think. And I'm glad to have, you know, really jumped on it. What Tassila said was really, really, in my view, really, really on point.
Thank you, Kirsten. Julia, would you like to say, add anything, or should I?
Maybe just really quickly, because I was thinking as Tassila was speaking, a few years ago, I followed with colleagues the development of educational resources coming out of Peru's Truth and Reconciliation Commission. And there were some very beautiful resources that really explored causes of conflict, but the ministry then decided to send them almost exclusively to Ayacucho, to regions of the country that were very heavily affected by conflict, like Tassila laid out, to primarily indigenous communities, seeing the resources as only relevant for them. Whereas these communities, like Tassila has explained, knew what happened in Peru's conflict because they lived it and were victimized by it. So it's this, and I think give the question talk too about settler colonial states. And as a Canadian, I've been following Canada's Truth Commission exploring the experience of residential schooling, and then the calls to action that have come out of that, which have been very educated. The whole commission is educationally focused. But I think there's a similar thing happening there, where some of the pedagogical changes to confront the kinds of ignorance that Kirsten was highlighting are directed towards communities that already know, and the conversations that need to be had amongst people who've benefited thanks to their privilege from these systems, that those kind of educational difficult dialogues, emotive dialogues, but really important and necessary ones that challenge that ignorance and see the ways that that ignorance maintains the structures that Kirsten was outlining. That's the real challenge. Well, I mean, there's tons of real challenges, right? But that's part of this process of trying to think in reparatory ways about education. And it is this sort of pattern around how to ensure that those dialogues and discussions happen for everyone and aren't just left to as the responsibilities of Indigenous communities, racialized communities, communities that have been victims of violence.
Thank you. There is a set of questions in the Q&A that link to this, and I'm looking at questions posed by Janbi and Alina, for example, that are really trying to question whether our current frameworks around the Sustainable Development Goals and development are radical enough to achieve the kind of transformation that people have been talking about with respect to reparative justice. And I'm using the term radical because that's a word that the people who have posed the questions have used. So I just wanted to invite some reflections from the panel about their views of the Sustainable Development Goals in relation to their own work.
I can go ahead. I've incidentally just written a paper on the Sustainable Development Goals and its relationship to development finance, and how it's within the UN system, there is a call and an increasing call or increasing sense that you need more and more capital in order to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals, to achieve actions and targets related to climate change and mitigating climate change. And in my view, it leads us actually down the path that of the very much the same of at least over the last 40 years of global neoliberalism, right? Of the fact that capital is trying to find ways of gaining a return on its investments. And the ways in which it's doing so in communities that are most affected by climate change is turning to the investors to invest in climate action, right? I find it's a bit of a paradox in the sense that investors who have and in themselves have caused some of the problem, they're now trying to invest in the devastation or in the aftermath of the devastation that some of these countries and communities are facing. So it is in my view, a continuation of the kinds of colonialities and colonial process that I think, especially rooted in development finance discussions in the Sustainable Development Goals.
Thank you. Do either of Julia or Tassila wish to jump in?
Sí. ODS. Bueno, tenemos todavía Plan de Acción de Cairo, Plan de Acción de Beijing, hubo el ODM, ahora tenemos ODS, ¿no? Hemos pasado más de 50 años de tratar de construir paz. Entonces, yo creo que aquí, relacionando con la educación también, tenemos que ser críticos acerca de cómo los políticos se forman y miran un solo lado, la economía y el poder. No miran el otro lado y entonces se comprometen a acuerdos como los ODS, pero nosotros vemos cómo la política de desarrollo económico en los países es totalmente contrario a lo que se comprometieron. Como por ejemplo, los acuerdos en las conferencias sobre cambio climático, ¿no? Bajar las emisiones, etcétera. Pero están dando concesiones mineras en territorio indígena para depredar la naturaleza y tener lo poco que dejan las empresas extractivas. Entonces es una contradicción. Tiene que haber toda una revisión de la gobernanza y los aspectos relacionados cómo generar economía sin dañar ni depredar los recursos no renovables. Nosotros en nuestra región tenemos todo el impacto de las empresas, de las transnacionales de todo tipo. Ustedes ven, ensucian el agua, le quitan tierras a las comunidades y a los pueblos indígenas, no respetan ni reconocen derechos. Entonces, por ejemplo, los primeros objetivos de desarrollo, erradicar el hambre, la pobreza, llegamos hasta por lo menos el 5, incluyendo la educación. ¿Cómo se articula en una política desde el Estado para lograr esos objetivos? No hay articulación. En nuestros países, cada sector está por un lado, educación por un lado, salud por otro, economía por otro y Ministerio del Ambiente por otro. ¿Quién tiene el poder en nuestros países? Ministerio de Economía. Entonces, si el Ministerio del Ambiente dice hay que cuidar el agua dulce, pero si ahí hay oro, el Ministerio de Energía y Minas autoriza. Entonces, lo que nosotros creemos es que a través de la educación tenemos que llegar a una formación de generación que ejerza poder con una mirada y una mentalidad diferente. Podemos desarrollar economía. ¿De qué otras maneras? ¿Y qué significa ser desarrollado? También está todavía en discusión. Entonces, ¿qué significaría tener vida plena, sana? ¿No? Es todo eso, creo que está en discusión y cada cual tenemos diferentes corrientes, pero esas corrientes no se encuentran para tener un punto medio. Y ese es el gran problema en el mundo, que cada cual decimos esta es nuestra verdad. Y por eso los indígenas, al menos nosotros, pedimos una educación intercultural desde el sistema nacional. No educación intercultural solo para los indígenas, para los afrodescendientes o los oprimidos. Tenemos que ser todos, todos tenemos que cambiar acá. Hasta nosotros tenemos que cambiar perdiéndole miedo al diferente, perderle el miedo al blanco, al que tiene más dinero, al que tiene mejores recursos y que podemos dialogar, que Julia y yo podamos conversar sobre estos temas porque no nos separa nuestros orígenes, sino que nos une nuestras preocupaciones. A eso tenemos que llegar. ¿Cómo con Kingston podemos conversar sobre el impacto de la esclavitud y el racismo en los sectores pobres, indígenas y afrodescendientes? No nos separa el hecho de que él sea un estudioso, un académico. Nos debe juntar esa común preocupación porque nosotros mismos estamos matando lo que nos da vida, respirar y tener recursos para las siguientes generaciones. O sea, ¿cómo logramos eso en una propuesta educativa y ejercicio del poder razonablemente?
Thank you, Tassila. Julia, do you have any thoughts you'd like to add?
One very quick one around the Sustainable Development Goal agenda and it's whether it's radical enough as the question was wondering. When the SDGs came out and I saw that there was a justice goal, I was like, oh wow, like this is a big departure from the Millennium Development Goals. Like we've got a specific goal around justice and just institutions and peace. But the indicators for that goal, when you look at them, the lead indicator is reduction in homicide rates. The indicators that follow are similar things around kind of numbers of babies that are registered and due process being followed and all things, of course, that are very important, but that really show a very legalistic, very narrow interpretation of what justice might be. And I think sometimes we get lost in like measuring, how would we measure justice? So we have to have these indicators that we gather and we have data on, but it's not impossible to imagine indicators around progress towards epistemic justice, environmental justice, forms of social justice like we've discussed today. It is possible to imagine those things. And I think it is important for us in our global agendas that we make these definitions, so these goals that we're imagining and committing ourselves to, so much richer and so much bigger, wider, broader, and more ambitious and exciting, so that people can see themselves represented within them as well.
Thank you so much. I know that everyone listening would have been absolutely inspired by all of your contributions today, Tasila, Julia, Keston. It's been an absolute privilege to listen and learn with you, alongside you. To all those who are listening, this series of events will be drawn together and written up as part of a report that we are putting together for UNESCO. So we look forward to sharing that with you in due course. As I mentioned, all the recordings are available up on the University of Bristol website. So please do revisit some of these ideas. I think that these are ideas that are worth coming back to as we keep thinking with them. I'd like to quickly invite Leon Tickley, if you're available, Leon, just to offer a couple of closing words before we sign out for the evening.
Yes, thank you very much, Arathi. And I just feel very humbled and privileged to have been part of such a stimulating and rich discussion this evening. I think this evening, along with the other two seminars in the series, we've learned that the idea of sustainable futures, of sustainable education futures, is absolutely inseparable from the whole debate around decolonizing. If we want to ensure that our futures are all of our futures, and not just some of our futures, and it's important to do away with what Boaventura de Sousa Santos calls the abyssal line. It seems to privilege some views of the future over others and treat some forms of humanity as somehow superior over others. And of course, education has been complicit in this process through reproducing a Eurocentric view of the world. And I think what we've learned over the last 3 weeks is the absolute importance of bringing different ways of knowing the world, of knowing and understanding our futures together, if we are going to save the planet. I've learned an awful lot today around the role of education in reparative futures, its material aspects from Keston, how fascinating, and from Tarsila as well. The role of education in relation to marginalizing, processes of marginalizing indigenous cultures and knowledges, but also from Julia and from all the panelists, the tremendous potential that education has to realize epistemic justice and sustainable futures. So on behalf of the UNESCO Chair at Bristol, I'd like to thank from the bottom of my heart, the panelists tonight, all the contributors, our colleagues in UNESCO, Dr. Keith Holmes, Professor Noah Sobey from the Futures of Education Initiative, my colleagues in SIA, Arathi Shriprakash, Julia Paulson, Raphael Mitchell, Artemio Cortez, Angeline Barrett, Michael Crossley, all of the colleagues who have helped to put this event together. And a special thanks to Christine Smith, who has worked behind the scenes to facilitate everything, and to our translator for this evening, Rosemary. Thank you, everybody, so much. And most especially to all of the contributors, the people who have come along these 3 weeks and contributed so richly to the conversation and the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Leon. And now it's just time to say good luck and stay safe. Be well, everybody, and let's meet again soon. Bye-bye.